beautiful morning the Lord has given us again. We have some announcements here. Russ has got something for us right away.
I just needed my remote control. I'm kidding. Good morning.
Good morning.
One of the announcements we wanted to make this morning, as a church leadership, we've had a particular item on our hearts for a while now. And we have spent about a year looking for and trying to find someone we could bring in to be involved with our youth group that could do this on a regular basis. We've had amazing volunteers, and I want to say thank you to every single person that's volunteered with our youth over the last year. We know that our youth is the future of our church. We know how important they are to the family of our church, and we want to make sure that they have someone that can be there to guide them and help them. The difficulty has been finding that right person over the last year. What we've done as a church leadership over the year have realized, rather than have a full-time position at the moment, what is best and what God has really led us to do is to provide an internship. A little different than a typical role with our church. This internship, what it allows us to do is not only be a support group as leaders for someone who's looking to become part of ministry in general, and to help guide them and lead them down a path that helps develop them, but also helps fill that role, at least, you know, momentarily for our church as well, with, you know, a variety of options long term. That internship, what we've decided to do, and a lot of prayer, a lot of thought went into this throughout both the elder board and the deacon board. What we've decided to do is provide that internship from now until May, and God has blessed us with a wonderful candidate to fill that internship from now until May. So I want to take the opportunity to introduce him to the church family. Over the first few months of that internship, the real responsibility there is to get to know all of us, to get to know all of you as our church family, all of the youth, to be able to participate in children's church and different Bible studies, and really just become part of the family that this church is. And then we'll progress that internship over the next few months. But I want to take a moment to introduce him. Keegan Maybert will fill in that internship for us from now until May. I'm gonna give Keegan a moment to go ahead and introduce himself, but please, after service today, make sure you take a moment to introduce yourself to Keegan and get to know him.
Well, good morning. My name is Keegan Maybert. I'm from Lowell, Michigan, so, you know, about an hour south of here. I knew Simon, Pastor Simon, from church a few years ago when we went to Calvary Church together. And he kind of brought this to be upon me, and I guess through, of course, God's helping hand and just seeing how he's been able to kind of lead the way and pave the way to me to be here. I'm super excited to be here. So if you guys would like to come and meet me afterwards, I'd love to meet you guys, just get to know you. I'm looking forward to just these next 8 months. One real quick thing, I know it might seem a little weird, but so my family grew up in this area. I am related to Barbara and Jack Kelly, and so my uncle is Tom Kelly, and my grandparents are Ann and Mike Kelly, so I'm sure that some of you guys know those names around here, and if you are related to them or just know them, I'd love to know that too. So I hope to meet you guys after the service, and I thank you so much for allowing me to be here and just get to know you guys. Thank you.
Let us stand for a prayer. Oh, quickly while you're standing, just a couple, three announcements. Next week is communion and potluck, so we might remember that. There is a Thanksgiving on October 10th at Brockway Wesleyan Church. All are invited. That would do it. Let us have a prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this gorgeous day you've given us, Lord, in this time of year. Just be with everyone and the farmers as they're harvesting their crops, and keep everybody safe, Lord. We just know that the abundance is from you. So we ask in thy name, amen. Okay, our opening song. Come, now is the time for worship.
Join us for the next song, Oh How Good It Is.
Presence here on
You may be seated, sorry. Time for prayers and praise.
Let's join in prayer together. Our Father, you are in heaven. You know everything and every need and every heart. Lord, we thank you for what you're doing in our church. We thank you for Keegan coming on board. And we pray that you will bless him and bless us through him. And we thank especially today of Simon and Laura and Aaliyah as they're on sabbatical, that you would just give them a time of refreshment. We ask that you also just prompt everybody to do what they need to do here at church. And we have so many wonderful requests, Lord. We thank you for everything that the doctors can do. We have a new member of the Pacemaker Club here at Sylvester. And Lord, thank you for her coming along well. And we thank you for birthdays. Except for theologically, it's really great to have another birthday. And Lord, we have a couple of requests for traveling mercies, and thank you for the opportunity that we can travel around and just enjoy each other and nature. We have several folk that are very ill. We have a great grandson. We have daughter and family. And Lord, there are so many folks with serious cancer treatments and COVID. Lord, thank you for the fact that you have promised that you're in every atom. We pray for procedures. Thank you for the praise we had regarding a race and knees and rain. And Lord, what a great opportunity to praise that is. And we thank you for those that we've been praying for with different issues. And there are undoubtedly a host of folk here that have special needs that they didn't bring to our attention. But Lord, thank you that you know every heart and you know how to work those things out. We especially would like to note the praise from Second Chance about our big turnout and wonderful program we had. And we think of specifically of young ladies playing rugby. Lord, we pray that you will strengthen and help her in all her endeavors. And we have a brother who is in need of some specific prayers. And Lord, thank you for the fact that you've said cast all our cares on you because you care for us. Pray that you will continue to bless us here at Sylvester Church. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Okay, we have another song. So let's stand, Make Me a Blessing. And during the song, the children are released to go down to the church.
Making the sorrowing glad. Make me a blessing.
3, 1 through 17. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must rid yourself of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge of the in the image of its creator. Here there is no Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you are called to peace. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing praises, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to the God, the Father, through him. Steve is now going to bring us our message.
Well, hopefully those verses sounded familiar to the men that have been coming to the Wednesday men's Bible study, because Tim's had us reading those verses for several weeks now, and I appreciate the way that he has us read through those aloud as a group. And in fact, that's kind of what inspired me to bring those verses to the church body today. And just a note, too, about the songs. For those of you saying, didn't we just sing those songs, Make Me a Blessing and Oh How Good It Is, 2 weeks ago? Well, Joan picked out those songs, and when I came 2 weeks ago, I said, I got to have those for my sermon today. So I asked that we could do those again today, because it just seems like the Make Me a Blessing and Oh How Good It Is to Be Part of This Family really fit in well with these verses. Okay, I'm going to do something a little bit different this morning. Start out kind of like we would in children's church. So we're in children's church right now. One of my favorite times is recalling what we've done before. So we're going to pretend that we are familiar with the story of Gideon and how he battled against the Midianites. This is found in the book of Judges, chapter 6, 7, and 8. So what I'd like you to do is raise your hand if you can tell me anything about that story of Gideon. Connie. You got it. That's one of the things that people remember from the story of Gideon, is the story of the fleece, because God had told Gideon, I want you to go defeat the Midianites, and Gideon said, well, hold on a minute. Just to be sure, like you're saying, he said, I want to put out a fleece, and I don't remember the order, but one of the days the fleece was supposed to be dry and the ground wet. And then Gideon said, okay, that worked. Let's try it the other way. So the next day he said, I want the fleece to be wet and the ground dry, and it was. So that's part of that story of Gideon. Okay, anybody else? Mike.
He overprepared.
Took too many men. You're right. In the story, Gideon calls Israelites to come, and 32,000 respond. And God says, that's too many. And so Gideon says, all right, those of you that are afraid can leave. And so 22,000 leave, which isn't surprising because the Midianite army was 135,000. Okay, so they're facing a huge army. So 22, so they're left with 10,000, and God says to Gideon, that's still too many. And so you probably heard the story about where he says, take the men to drink at the river and watch how they drink. Do they lap the water, getting down on their knees and put their tongue in the water, or do they lift it up with their hands? And so Gideon does that, and 300 men, I think, drink by lapping the water out of their hands. And God says to Gideon, okay, there's your army. So now you're down to 300 men. Okay, anything else that we recall about that story? You guys are doing well, especially since we didn't really have this a few weeks ago. Tim?
Jars and torches.
Not only are you recalling this, but you're recalling it in order. That's good. Doesn't get me so confused. Yeah, with this army of 300, you would think, okay, let's get ourselves armed as much as possible because we're going against 135,000. And Tim's probably already figuring, okay, 135,000 versus 300, that's like 430-some guys per person that Gideon's army's got to defeat. I don't know about you, but I wouldn't want to have to face over 400 people myself. But anyways, he arms them with a torch that he puts in a clay jar and a bugle or a trumpet, some kind of horn. That's their weapon. Okay, and then as the story goes, the Gideon's army surrounds the Midianites at night. Midianites are sleeping. Gideon, on his signal, blows a horn. All this Gideon's army takes out their torches, so all of a sudden there's all kinds of lights flashing around. They blow their horns, they break the jars, they make all kinds of noise. The Midianite army wakes up. God causes them to be confused. So what do they do in their confusion? All this noise and all these lights going off around them? They kill each other. Okay? And who doesn't get killed as they kill each other runs off. And then Gideon and his army pursue them and take care of them. So you see a huge army of 135,000 men get defeated by killing themselves. Okay, that gets us to Colossians now. Okay, just getting started, Wayne, sorry. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word to us and the numerous ways that you show your love and how you care for us and defend us. Lord, I thank you for giving us these instructions on how we can function as a body of believers. We just pray, Jesus, that we can look to you in your name. Amen. The Midianites defeated themselves, but that's not exclusive to just the Midianite army. In the book of Galatians, okay, and a little bit before we get to Colossians, we're still not to Colossians yet, Paul says, who cut in on you and kept you from obeying the truth? He's talking to the Christian church at this time. And then a few verses later in Galatians 5:15, he said, if you keep on biting and devouring each other, watch out or you'll be destroyed by each other. Sounds a lot like what happened with the Midianite army. Now, I am not suggesting that Sylvester Church is biting and devouring one another. I love this church, and I think this church is doing a great job of displaying God's love and loving one another. However, is Satan going to come after a church that's dead, or is he going to come after a church that's alive? He's going to come after a church that's doing well, that's loving God and loving one another, because he doesn't want that to happen. So we would be foolish to think that, hey, we've got it made, we're doing a pretty good job, let's just keep going the way things are, and we'll be all set. I don't think that that's what God intends for us. He wants us to be watchful, especially since you think about Gideon's story about all those jars breaking, the horns blowing, the men were all shouting, a sword for the Lord and for Gideon. Well, they didn't even have swords, but they shouted that they had the swords. So there's all this racket going on. Well, think about the racket that we face as a church right now. For example, within the church, we hear the tremendous theological discussions such as, do we have pews or do we have chairs? Do we sing hymns or do we do contemporary music? Do we have a traditional service, whatever that is, versus a modern or contemporary service, whatever that is? Long sermons, short sermons. Again, Wayne, I'm not sure how long this is going to go today. We'll see. That's just to name a few of the things that go in the church, not to mention the scriptural differences that have divided churches. Well, then you look at also then add in the voices of what we hear around the world now. We've got life versus choice, black versus white, Democrats versus Republican, open border versus closed border, LGBTQ plus versus straight, religion versus science. And I keep saying versus. I think that's man a lot of times putting the verses in there, like religion versus science. Science really backs up the Bible. It's not a versus there where, oh yeah, if I believe the Bible, I can't believe science. I think they go together. Or black versus white. Who's trying to put a wedge in there? It should be the races don't matter. But the world does that. CRT, global warming, all these things are all that clamor that's around us. And now what have we added to it in the last couple of years? All of a sudden we have this COVID that comes, and so now we've got the masked versus unmasked question, the vaccine or no vaccine, quarantine versus no quarantine, keep your distance, faith over fear. All these things, all these opinions, these voices around us. So as a church, we really need to say, all right, how are we going to battle against these so that we aren't driven to where we're biting and devouring one another? Because believe me, it has happened. It has happened in churches. I give Simon a lot of credit. That man has heard a lot of things over the past couple of years where he's a pastor of a diverse group. Hears a lot of opinions. And he wants to make sure that those that he's hearing from know that they're loved by God. And knowing that they are listened to. And that's quite a challenge. So, the Midianites placed their confidence, I think, in their numbers, 135,000. Gideon was told by God, Gideon, it's not going to be you that delivers your people from the Midianites. It's going to be God. So Gideon put his confidence in God. I feel like I got a different sound going on now. All set? Okay. So we need to do the same. We need to put our confidence in God. Last week, Richard spoke about in the book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, about Jesus being our foundation. He said, verse 11, for no one can lay any foundation than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. Colossians continues that today in Colossians 3:1. Finally got to Colossians, where it says, since then you've been raised with Christ. Paul is saying, are you ready? You've been raised with Christ. And what does that mean? Well, in Colossians chapter 2, he says, when you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your sinful nature, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the written code with its regulations that was against us and that stood opposed to us. He took it away, nailing it to the cross, and having discerned the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. God has already triumphed. We have that victory in us, and so if we're placing our faith in Jesus, then we are the ones that he's talked to, those of you that are raised with Christ. And I would just urge you today that if you're someone that hasn't put your faith in Jesus, that this would be a great day to do that. So, once we're ready by placing our faith in Christ, then Paul goes on to give us some instructions about, okay, now that you have this faith, how should you live as a church? So he says, set your hearts on things above, set your minds on things above, so that you'll have your heart and mind set on Christ. He echoes this in Hebrews 12:2. I like this verse where it says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. We're just going to keep hearing over and over again today that it's Jesus. Jesus is the answer for us. If we keep our eyes fixed there, then we can tune out those things that want to distract us and draw us away from God. I went on a sailing trip a couple weeks ago. My brother-in-law, Brad, has a 36-foot sailboat, big boat, at least it is to me. And he goes, and my other brother-in-law, Chuck, the three of us go out on the, we used to call it a fishing trip, but then we never caught any fish. So we had to change it to a sailing trip. Brad's the only one that knows how to sail. So he does all the complicated stuff and tries to find something that Chuck and I can do that doesn't mess up what he's doing. One of those things is, though, he'll have us pilot the boat. Okay, while he's up there adjusting the sails or whatever. And piloting a sailboat actually is a challenge. You need to get a waypoint set off in the distance that you're going to aim that boat toward and then keep going in that direction. But the thing that, while you're doing that, is you've got wind coming in because hopefully you're sailing. So you got the wind coming in that's blowing the boat. Lake Michigan has some big waves. Okay, so you've got a boat that now is going like this, or it's going like this. The waves are crossing. So you're trying to set a course on a waypoint that's off in the distance, so you've maybe picked a spot on the horizon. By the way, don't pick clouds. They move. I found that out. So you pick out your waypoint, and all of a sudden the boat gets this way. So you're sitting on the steering wheel's here, and you got a bench that's to the side of it. So you're like this. You got one hand holding on to a wire that's coming for supporting the mast, because if you don't, then you're going to be all over the place because that boat's going all over the place. And you're trying to steer the boat like this, and you're trying to keep your view on that waypoint. And then the boat starts doing that lean, so then you're either, you know, leaning into the steering wheel or you're falling away from the steering wheel all the time trying to steer it. A lot of distractions. It's not an easy job. My brother-in-law Chuck does a nice job with that. And you can see that Brad's doing that and Chuck's doing the driving, and they have me pulling some ropes to tighten the sails sometimes. Anyways, these winds, waves, the things that distract us while sailing are similar to what God mentions in verse 5, where he says, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Those are the things that draw us away from God. Those are all about our earthly, natural wants and desires, but they're not about what God wants. So those are the things that are going to be that pull that if we don't keep our focus, they're going to draw us away. You see those manifested in things such as the drugs, alcohol, pornography, the overeating, desire for money, gambling. All these things are the things that where our earthly nature manifests itself in our lifestyle. Then he goes on to say in verse 8, but now you must rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other. So now he's getting into a lot of the things that have to do with our speech or what comes out of our heart, the anger that can come that builds in our heart. In fact, it says in Matthew 12:34, you brood of vipers, how can you who are evil say anything good? For out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. Luke 6:45, the good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart, and the evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in his heart. For out of the overflow of his heart, his mouth speaks. So you think back to Colossians, where it says at the beginning of it, set your hearts on things above, back in the first verse of chapter 3. And you can see why Paul is telling us that, because if we don't set our hearts on the things above, if we're not filled with the goodness that God has for us, and out of that we can have an overflow in our speech and in what we do, then we're going to get filled up with the stuff that's around us. Okay, and that's going to be what's overflowing out of our hearts and then out of our mouths and into our actions. Has anyone lost power around here lately? Yeah, I remember a few weeks ago when the power was off for 5 days, and I feel bad for the stores, the businesses that have had to go through that more than once. We have a whole house generator that doesn't do the whole house because not all the circuits are on it. So it's a challenge each time to remember, well, what things do work. We have a pantry right by our kitchen that's not on the generator. But there are several times while during that 5 days the power's off that I, as I'm leaning into the pantry to get something, I'm reaching over here, I'm flicking that switch. Power's been off, I'm still turning that switch. 3 or 4 days, I'm still flicking that switch. Power's not coming on, the light's not coming on. Finally, about the time I start thinking, okay, it's not going to work, well, then the power does come back on. Okay, but that, to me, shows how once we get in a habit of doing something, it's tough to break that habit. Okay, once we, you know, as we're looking at how do we get off this old self, get rid of all these things, well, if it's something that's become a habit in our lives, it's not going to necessarily be easy. Now, Richard, a few weeks ago, was sharing his testimony. And I think, if I recall correctly, Richard, you shared how with tobacco, that desire seemed to leave you fairly quickly, right? Yeah, exactly. That God chooses to work that way sometimes, that he may take something that you are trying to get rid of, and he may just say, okay, it's gone. That temptation's gone. You don't have that desire anymore, and you can just celebrate that. But as often the case, it doesn't work that way. God doesn't just take it away immediately. He gives you the power to combat it. In fact, it says here in 1 Corinthians 10:13, no temptation has seized you except what is common to man. But God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will provide a way out so you can stand up under it. Or he'll provide you a way to escape. So you're trying to break that habit, let's say, of the filthy language that comes from your lips. Well, it might be that God's saying, hey, I've got some verses for you to study, for you to learn, so that those are the verses that come to mind. Or it might be where he has, I think of the music that we sing. One of the ways that I am blessed is when Joan sends us, you know, here's the songs we're going to be doing this week. A lot of times I try to practice those songs because I need a lot of practice. Those songs go through my mind then. Like, that make me a blessing. The last couple weeks, I can't get rid of it. And which is good because I haven't exactly been a blessing, so I probably need to keep hearing that over and over again. But those are the ways I think that God gives us when he talks about, I will provide a way to escape. He's giving us his word. It might be one of you is the way to escape for someone else, that you're coming alongside someone and your word of encouragement is there, what they need to hear in order to have that escape from something that they're trying to get rid of. Or it might be the testimony. I know we have some men in here. Mike has shared with about alcohol. Correct, Mike, I don't want to overstep here. So his sharing, that testimony can speak to other men or women that have that same problem, and they can look and say, there's a man that's come through to the other side. That can help them find their way of escape. That's the, one of the ways that God gives us, gives his power to us, is us working together. Okay, let's see, where am I here now? All right. Verse 10 says, and having put on the new self. I like this because God is saying, you've got this earthly nature, let's get rid of that. But he doesn't just leave it at that and say, hey, This is all the negative. Now, find your way on your own. He says, I got a new self for you, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Okay, here there is no Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Again, it comes down to Jesus being the answer here. There's no Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised. He's saying, let's not get caught up in nationality, culture, race, economic status, our legalism, all those things that we want to bring into the mix. What political party, all those things. But Christ is all and is in all. Verse 12 is one of my favorite verses out of this passage. It says, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved. That's pretty amazing. We get to know that. God chooses us. He loves us, and he desires to make us holy. Have you ever been part of on the playground or someplace where you're choosing up teams, and you got your two captains, and then they're picking who's going to be on their team? Have you ever been where you're thinking, I hope I get picked, choose me kind of thing, and it goes longer and longer, and you're not chosen? Some people, that's never been a concern, but for other people, it's like, yeah, am I going to get chosen? Well, the good news here is God chooses you. You don't have to wait. You don't have to say, God, pick me, please. It says that in Revelation 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Jesus is picking us. He's there saying, hey, open the door. Let me in. I want to come in and have fellowship with you. Okay, so we don't have to think at this point, as God's chosen people, he chooses us. He chooses you. Then he says, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Well, that's pretty easy to say. Where's that going to come from? That compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience? That's not typical. That doesn't come to us naturally. But if you look in Galatians 5:22, it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Kind of that same thing that just read in Colossians about clothe yourselves. So God is saying, yeah, I want you to clothe these things, but it says it's by the fruit of the Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit living in us that's going to bring about those things that I can try to muster all the gentleness, compassion, and so forth. But if I'm doing that apart from God, I'm setting myself up for failure. If I'm not filling myself up with Scripture, with the encouragement of being in a church body, then for me to try and muster up that goodness and patience and joy and peace, it's just not going to happen. I can maybe fake it for a while. I can go back to that earthly nature and say, hey, that whole idea of greed, give me enough money and I'll be happy, right? Yeah, that's one of the ways we fake it. Or give me enough alcohol, give me enough drugs, give me enough of this, of this, of this, and that'll be joy. I'll be great. That's not God's way, though. Bear with each other. This is, I think, verse 13 or so. Notice that when it says bear with each other, it's not saying be a bear with each other. Because I can fall into that. And forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Whoa. You can almost hear the church saying, well, wait a minute. Forgive? But you don't know what that person said about me or what that person did or, yeah, how much they owe me, whatever. And then he goes on, the last part of verse 13 says, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And all of a sudden, it's like, okay, I guess I can forgive whatever Jan has said about me. Well, maybe. if I think about what Jesus has done for me in terms of forgiveness, the pain that he went through on the cross for me, that he didn't have to go through, that he chose to go through because of my sins, then certainly I should be able to forgive someone else. And it wasn't just Jesus going through that pain. Think about his Father in heaven, seeing his Son on this cross, going through this pain, and then this time of separation where it had to be just such agony. And yet, it was endured for us. So I should be able to endure what little pain or suffering or agony that I need to go through in order to forgive someone, because Jesus has done it for me. Over all these virtues, put on love. This is verse 14, which binds them together in perfect unity. I'm going to just flip briefly to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It's known as, I think, the love chapter. We could have many sermons about what is love, so I just thought I'd read a few verses here quickly. It says, love is patient, kind, does not envy, does not boast, it's not proud, it's not rude, it's not self-seeking, it's not easily angered, keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. So if we can put that as a church body, when we love one another, if we can put those verses in our hearts, then we can love one another and be able to love God. Paul closes this chapter 3 of Colossians with some more practical things that we can do. Three times he mentions being thankful. Verse 15 says, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you are called to peace. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 says, don't be anxious about anything. He's talking about how to get this peace, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And then this is the nice part. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. So I have that temptation to be anxious about something, and he's saying, let the peace of Christ rule. And I'm saying, well, how do I let the peace of Christ rule in my heart? He gives me the answer in Philippians when he says, whatever you do, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present. I need to present, what is that thing that's worrying me? I need to present that to God. And God's peace will come to me. Verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. I read that and I think, Paul's not saying, let the words of social media dwell in you richly. Not, don't let the words of books or TV shows or movies dwell in you richly. He's saying, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Spend some time learning this word, so that we know what God is saying to us. And finally, whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. I started the message and I said, ready, set, and go. Ready is, am I a believer? Set is setting our hearts and minds on Jesus and letting him transform our lives. But the go, what's the go? The go is in chapter 4 of Colossians, where it says, pray for us too that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should. Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity and let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. God isn't just about Sylvester Church loving one another and loving God and having a great church here, but he's also saying, out of this church, I want the gospel to be proclaimed so that others may know, so that they can see us and hear us, not to our glory, but that they'll be drawn to God, and that God will be glorified and praised. So that's the go part, that as we are encouraged and strengthened here in this body, that then God has proclaimed and his kingdom increases. I debated about sharing this final last thing, but it goes with the men's group, and they seem to enjoy it. We're reading this book by Tony Evans on Kingdom Men. And Tony Evans, now, pardon the language here a little bit, but he's talking about he was going through a rough time, and he was tempted to just stay in bed, and he knew that God wanted him to get up and do what he's supposed to do. And his wife had just died, but he knew if his wife was alive, she'd be saying, Tony, you get up, you know what you need to do. So he gets up, and he said, at that point, he said, Satan was saying, oh, crap, he got up. Sylvester Church, we're up. Satan saying, oh, crap, I don't like this. Okay, but if we keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, then we can stay up and shine for God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your love. Thank you for just all that you do, all who you are, Lord. I pray that you'll fix in us a desire to look to you. Lord, just give us daily reminders and help us to encourage one another. We just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, let us stand for our closing hymn. It is well.
Whatever my love.
conclude with this last song that we've been concluding with a couple of times. And this is actually a prayer in the Bible. And I'm going to guess, I think it's in Numbers. Go look. Anyway, as we're singing this, glance around the room and look at the people that are here. These are your family. And if anything, I think we want these words to go with us and with each other. And hold them close.
May we go in the blessing of God. You're dismissed.
For watching. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel by clicking the link on the upper left-hand side of your screen so you can see all of our videos when they come out. Or you can watch last Sunday's sermon by clicking the video link on the bottom left of your screen. From all of us at Sylvester Community Church, thank you and God bless.